Hey folks, and welcome to episode 102 of the Ocean Sailing Podcast. It's been a bit of a gap from the last episode until now, and I just wanted to give you an update really on my last 6 months on the Ocean Sailing Expeditions business and really the Silver Fern project, I guess, and to give you a bit of an appreciation of the impact that's had on podcast production and my ability to produce regular ongoing podcast content. So I want to really share that with you, give you a bit of an update, and I've got some good episodes waiting in the wings for editing production right now, so you'll start to see a regular stream again. Yes, to update you, particularly if you've been following my story over the past few months and in recent years, what I've been through in the last 12 months has been a really, really steep learning curve. And it's literally 12 months to the day that I purchased the sailing vessel Silver Fern in Auckland last year, in Whangarei last year. And it's been a really, really challenging road. And so, the goal of purchasing that yacht, making some upgrades, putting it into survey with Maritime New Zealand, I kind of figured at the time it would take about 8 weeks, flew across to New Zealand and went through quarantine and got my teeth into it in August last year. And here we are a year later, Maritime compliance and approvals took a total of 10 months. It really did consume me, that process, and I hit a few dead ends a few times. Hit some brick walls that looked insurmountable, but fortunately managed to get through those and get to the other side. And part of what's consumed me in the last 12 months, I guess, is with operating a sailing vessel internationally, the safety requirements for that, from an equipment through to safety systems, safety manuals, and processes, it's just a big thing to create, to document, to turn into a living, breathing, range of checklists and maintenance plans, and that really has been a big chunk of work. And that's resulted in having to, write from scratch a 150-page operations and safety manual, setting up yacht management technology systems to manage all of that. My refit project of Silver Fern, where I budgeted after purchasing the yacht, would be sort of around $180,000 to $250,000. Has now in the last 12 months clocked past $710,000, and so I guess the end result now a year on is a $1.1 million outlay for a vessel that initially I thought would be about $500,000 by the time I had it finished, but on the back of replacement value today for a 72-foot 30-ton sailing vessel, of $5 to $6 million if I was to build that new today, it's still a great yacht in great shape, almost brand new in lots of ways from the ground up, in terms of sails, rigging, electronics, rewire, plumbing, and a whole lot of technology that I've added to the vessel. It's essentially a new yacht for about 20% of the replacement cost. So that's been all consuming. It really has been. And the other thing that's I've learned along the way is upgrading and maintaining bigger boats. The costs go up exponentially, and they say that you can kind of double your costs between 45 and 55 feet. Well, certainly between 45 and 72 feet, the costs are probably three times what I had originally with my last Beneteau 45 yacht Ocean Gem. And so, in addition to the upgrade costs, the ongoing costs just really on preventative maintenance and preventative upgrades is around about $100,000 a year. And if you then start to throw in marina costs, insurance, operating costs, travel, meals, all the other compliance costs that go with a vessel like this, then those costs of operating that kind of vessel in this kind of business operation where it's actively at sea, 15 to 20 weeks a year, are around $300,000 to $400,000 a year in terms of operational costs. So it's a bit of a beast. Everything's doubled or tripled what I expected, and it's taken five times as long. But that's probably the par for the course with most sailing related projects. And you know, at the end of the day, I'm now approved. I'm in survey with Maritime New Zealand. I have unlimited survey approval. I can sail anywhere in the world. And Silver Fern is the only New Zealand sailing vessel that's actually in survey for unlimited operation under 24 meters in length with that certification. So, you know, it's been like being the oldest child in the family. Always harder than when you're the youngest. You've got to break your parents in and do all the hard yards. It's been a bit like that with Maritime New Zealand, where the laws really are written for, you know, fishing boats, tugboats, cruise ships, cargo ships. Then they're not written specifically for sailing vessels to be able to sail internationally, because the compliance is huge. So the, you know, I guess part of the challenge with all of this has been COVID-19 challenges have added to my headaches. I've had no lack of demand for bookings with people wanting to come sailing on Silver Fern. 2021 originally, a few months back, was 98% booked out, which was pretty cool, and gave me the confidence to keep going, to keep throwing more and more money at Silver Fern, with a view that the end picture made sense. And I always think it's a bit like starting an airline. You have to build the plane and put the wings on and put the seats in before you can start charging people to come flying with you. Well, the Silver Fern project's a bit like that, really. Although the costs have scaled dramatically, If I take a 10-year plus view, then the return on investment, if it makes sense over 10 years plus, then it makes sense for me. But to get out of the blocks, you can't get out of the blocks with a vessel that's 3/4 of the way there. It has to be safe, has to be approved, has to be reliable, has to be easy to manage, and people have to have a great time. And that's really the been my sort of driving goal along the way. So the Trans-Tasman borders and sort of travel bubble closing again has been a challenge. The internal Australian lockdown state by state has been a challenge. Border closures stopping people travelling into Queensland from places like New South Wales, South Australia and Victoria have been a challenge. Those things have all created chaos with cancelled events. We've recently had the Brisbane to Hamilton Island race cancelled with a few days' notice. Hamilton Island Race Week cancelled with 3 weeks' notice for the second year in a row. You can imagine for me having a vessel ready to go with people that are booked and paid to do races, to do regattas, and then planning to depart from Hamilton Island to sail to New Zealand. It's created chaos really in terms of the upheaval with replacing people from different states with those that can travel, i.e. People from New Zealand, Queensland, Western Australia, who can travel. It's just created just a lot of work, really. And so that's just par for the course. If I go back to October last year, once I was 2 months into this project, it was a real leap of faith, I guess, in uncertain economic times then. The borders were closed between New Zealand and Australia, and there was a lot of global uncertainty economically, as well as, where will this all end up? And leaving a full-time job as a partner and, I guess senior manager in a technology company and going full time into the sailing business was a real leap of faith, but it just felt right and it just made sense. And so I took that leap of faith with the support of my family, and it has been highly stressful at times, and the sheer workload and the scale of the upgrades, thousands of hours of work have now gone into the vessel by myself and multiple contractors. At times last year, we had weeks and weeks on end of 5 to 7 people at a time working full time on Silver Fern, doing all sorts of things, and working in and around that, juggling all of that, keeping people happy, keeping people on track, and dealing with all the setbacks that happen along the way has been a bit of a mission. Just the sheer volume of documentation. Somebody asked me a couple of months ago now, hey, can you send me the web page where it tells you how to put a vessel into international operation? I want to do what you've done. And I had to say that, there is no web page. But by the way, see these attachments. They're more than 1,000 pages of individual maritime regulations, about 25 or 30 of them, plus the Maritime Act, 300-odd pages, plus a whole bunch of other stuff. You need to read all of these to figure out, what makes sense for you and what applies to your vessel. There is no easy path, and good luck, because I wouldn't recommend this for anybody, and get yourself a good surveyor who understands sailing vessels, not just, you know, fishing and cargo and stuff. Otherwise, you'll just run a brick wall. So that was a mission. I've done 5 courses and 6 different examinations, you know, 4 of those being classroom style and 2 being practical. I've done more than 300 hours of study, from a personal, you know, skipper, sea captain, safety approved person to be able to be the master of Silver Fern in unlimited waters, which is another level above operating in coastal waters or offshore waters out to the 200 mile limit around most countries. And so that's been a challenge. The financial challenges of navigating a profitable path through all of this, when you overlay COVID and border closures and rising costs, have been challenging. And then, you know, splitting my time between doing my repairs and upgrades myself. I've currently got, you know, a must-do, nice-to-do, and one-day kind of to-do list that equals about 140 items for Silver Fern, and that's just an ongoing list. That also includes engaging electricians, you know, riggers, people making coverings for sun protection, hydraulic steering specialists, engine specialists, etc. And so managing all of that in the right order, and then making sure that parts are ordered and that they're available, and with the current lead times, and scheduling those around my sailing trips and adventures and expeditions and races is a job in itself, because if you don't manage that in the right order, then by the time the parts are arrived, the boat's gone, or by the time you get to a certain location, the expertise is not there, and so on and so forth. So that's been a real steep learning curve in terms of managing that, and obviously a heavier schedule makes it challenging again. And then my time's also split around planning, administration, compliance, answering emails, managing the marketing for ocean sailing podcast and ocean sailing expeditions, and then getting podcast production underway again. And in all of this, you know, even though this is full time for me, around about 25% of the time I get to go sailing, and that's just a reality. You can't sail full time in this kind of business, nor would you want to. I think you've got to have the time away and the time at home, but you know, there's so much to do in the downtime that there isn't really that much downtime. And of those of you who are cruising full time, know really that sailing boats is all about learning how to repair boats in exotic locations. That's what a lot of cruising is about, and you know, it's a way of life, and I love it. It's a whole new way of looking at the world for me. You know, at age 50 last year, I finally found what I wanted to do when I grew up. It just took a long time to get there. And today I'm sitting here on Silver Fern. I'm recording this podcast, and looking around, it still seems surreal to be working full time on my sailing business and my podcast business, which are both real passions. They overlap with each other. I have so many opportunities to capture great stories and share them. And that's, you know, it's a big part of what I do next, now that I'm starting to settle into an approved, operational, compliant business with borders starting to open. And I certainly know I've done a poor job of podcast episode production really in the last 12 months, I think. And, you know, I could say, look, I haven't had the time, I've been busy. And, you know, the answer is I could have made the time. And it's probably been more of a mental block. When I think about it, it's been more of a mental block in terms of the overwhelming scale of the Silver Fern project, walking away from a, you know, well-paid business and job, devoting my life to creating sailing adventures both on the water and obviously sharing the stories, and then managing the rising costs and the changes to the schedule, and then funding my family along the way. Now this is a full-time you know, job and business, not just a part-time passion. And you know, I guess in life there's so many times over the years that I've taken on too much, and I'm sure some of you have appreciated that listening to some of my earlier stories. But I've certainly learned in life that big projects, big goals require, you know, massive focus, and not just to get them done, not just to get there, but to do a great job of those to an excellent level, not just enough to get by, but equally you have to focus to avoid failure. And I think there's lots of good business ideas that fail not because the idea wasn't sound, just through lack of focus, lack of commitment. And you know, one of the things that that I did by walking away from a, you know, successful business, a successful, you know, full-time job, October, November last year, was, you know, when you burn the boats, as they say, and you've got nothing to fall back on, no plan B, then you have to make plan A work. And sometimes you just have to devote all of your physical and mental energy to a challenge like this to have any chance of succeeding, particularly if you're pioneering and doing something that hasn't been done before and isn't commonplace. And international sailing across the Tasman isn't commonplace. There isn't anyone else doing that. And I don't say that to boast or gloat. It's just that there's just pitfalls you don't know until you hit them, because you haven't got a model to follow. And I've had more than my share of fair share of those, but equally I've been probably never more determined than on this project. So, you know, you have to also have a complete mental break at times when you're not working on a project that's all consuming. Otherwise you hit the wall and get burned out. And I have, you know, going back to October, November 2019, I was hitting the wall and I was burned out juggling a part-time sailing business, juggling a family, juggling a very demanding technology business, and working long hours in that, then going away sailing and then coming back to a backlog, et cetera, et cetera. So you know, it's as Winston Churchill said, you know, if you find yourself in hell, keep going. And you know, this is the kind of project where sometimes you find yourself at really hard places, and all you can do is just keep moving forward, just keep taking steps and moving forward. And because stopping doesn't solve it. You can't, once you've got a half finished project, you know the value is nothing. You can't sell it, you can't walk away from it, and you never learn unless you keep going with these things. And so, you know, in summary, podcast episodes will start to flow again more regularly now. I can't promise that they'll be every week, but I can promise there'll be podcasts flowing, and sometimes there'll be three or four at once. Sometimes there'll be nothing for a month. And as this business grows and scales, I will get better at it and start to bring other people on board that can then start to do a good job of the editing and production for me. Capturing the story is not the hard part. The editing afterwards and doing all the other work with cover artwork and bits and pieces and, you know, uploading. And even that, you know, to upload podcast files, you've got to have good internet. And the last 12 months, my time on board, my time at sea, my time with poor internet just made life hard too. So no excuses though. I had to get this project finished. I had to get it viable and working, and it's just probably crossed that threshold in the last month or so. And I guess, you know, this is just, you know, this episode's part of saying thanks to all of you who have been patient. Thanks to those who have prompted me by saying, hey, are you still doing the podcast? Are there more episodes coming? Where are you up to? But also all the support I've had for the Silver Fern project, the people that have helped out, the people that have jumped on board, the people that have committed time, committed money, been sailing with me already, and shared some of those adventures. And even as recently as the last 4 weeks, you know, I could not be more grateful for, you know, 95% of the people when given a choice, when I've had to change the schedule, cancel races, cancel events, who've said, look, I really want to come sailing. Can you just transfer me to a future event? I don't really want to cancel. I don't really want a refund. I just want to go sailing. So what else can I do? Can I do next year's event instead? Can I change to something else? And that's all helped massively. And as you can imagine, if you've got people coming sailing and people booked in to do stuff, having mass cancellations and cancelled events because of COVID-related issues does create all sorts of chaos at a personal level. For those people that have put time aside, who've made travel plans, have committed cost to getting to Silver Fern or home afterwards, not to mention the disappointment of cancellations because of border closures. So, you know, I do feel that I'm creating something special that people want to be a part of. I've witnessed that over and over now. Even with contractors working on Silver Fern, you know, my gratitude to them along the way, despite the challenges and setbacks and missed deadlines, they still went out of their ways. They worked after hours. They dropped things at short notice for me. They've worked weekends and they've put other work off and created stress with other customers because of the scale of the project. So, you know, I am grateful and I really do appreciate that, because I wouldn't be here without all of those people. So it's a growing pleasure to sail on Silver Fern. And I don't say that from a promotional point of view, it's just my confidence in handling Silver Fern as a sailing vessel, and the systems management of the vessel is growing. As you know, upgrades have fallen into a place, and a fixed and overcome setbacks, then you know, reliability and continuity give you confidence, and you know, you just start to enjoy your sailing more and more. And if you've ever sailed with a vessel where you've got three or four things that are bugging you, and they're in the back of your mind, and you're not quite happy with them, and then the refrigeration stops, or the engine stops, or you have a rigging issue, or you know, or the bow thruster stops, or you know, blah blah blah. When you eliminate those things that niggle away at you, that are showstoppers, then you just start to relax and enjoy your sailing a whole lot more. And with any boat, you know, you have the things that are must-dos that you really need to be able to count on, and you have the things that are nice-to-dos. And once the must-dos are under control, it's amazing how you sort of your view on the vessel changes, and your composure changes when there's problems, and it becomes more enjoyable. And you know, even fixing things is in a funny kind of way becomes enjoyable when they're not deal breakers. So certainly, I've got this philosophy of fix it once, fix it forever. And that kind of attitude is expensive at times. And what I mean by that is, don't just replace what's broken. Look at why it broke, why it wore out. Could it have been designed better? Was it really fit for purpose? Is there chafe issues, wear issues, rust issues, rot issues that have been caused by how it was set up? What do we need to do to fix it this time so that we take a leap into the future with a much better solution that lasts longer, lasts forever, is more reliable, can be maintained, et cetera, et cetera. And so that's never about putting a Band-Aid on. That's never about cheap solutions. They almost never pay off. It's taking that, you know, take the hit, accept that it's not great, that it's broken, it's not working, and then start with, okay, how do I make it bulletproof? How do I make it easy to maintain? How do I give myself peace of mind for the future and just take the pain now? And if that's spending $1,500 today instead of $1,000 today, but hey, the pain's gone for 10 years plus, then it's worth that extra investment now, particularly when you're using a boat a lot. You all know how disruptive that can be when your plans have to change, and particularly when you're away with family or friends, and you have to pull into ports of refuge to find repairs or wait for parts to arrive. So the development of my knowledge of fixing and maintaining Silver Fern is growing. It's just a reality that I have to carry more spares, more tools than I've ever carried on board my previous vessel. I have to be able to maintain and fix the vessel at sea. And if we end up in remote locations, then I have to be able to undertake repairs on the reality that the skills aren't available. The parts could be days or weeks away. And you know, that's part of a bit like running an airline. If your plane's grounded every second week for repairs, then it doesn't work. People lose confidence. Your revenue's all over the place. Your schedule's always, you know, running behind or has to be changed all the time. And Silver Fern's kind of like that. It's that kind of mindset that you have to have in terms of being on time and running to a schedule and providing a reliable experience. And you know, all of that idealism aside, I have had lots and lots of challenges and lots of things go wrong along the way. And you know, again, with the combination of people we have on board, the people I have on board in chief mate, co-skipper roles, they come from a qualified background, who are paid contract crew with experience and expertise. They've been a godsend, particularly in areas where I haven't had the skills or experience around some of the electrical stuff and around some of the engine stuff. You know, the people that join us on these trips, you know, as much as it's challenging and frustrating at times, it's also part of the adventure. We had a simple thing. We had two brand new fill filters installed, so I had, you know, I could switch between them if there was a fuel contamination issue, and one of the fuel lines installed just because it wasn't supported properly, slowly bent over to a sort of a 60 degree angle and kinked the pipe, and then our generator wouldn't start, or it would start and stop. Couldn't figure out why, and just by chance, one of the crew on board, David, was a diesel engine mechanic, figured it out. You know, it didn't cost anything to fix it. It was just having that knowledge problem solving by identifying the issue, bleeding the generator, and then away it went again. So, you know, so that's been a steep learning curve as well, and so much more focus on prevention, checks pre-departure, and making sure all systems are working and then maintaining them to a schedule so that reliability is there. So, you know, under my approved operations, under Maritime New Zealand, and whether it's AMSA or US Coast Guard, you know, there's rules in place, you know, globally for operating vessels in international waters as opposed to, you know, the offshore 200 mile limits that are pretty universal. And so I have to have chief mates that are really co-skippers on board that have what's called a master of yachts, up to 24 meters in terms of certification, as well as either yacht master offshore and or yacht master ocean qualifications, plus firefighting, plus first aid, plus sea safety and survival. And so that on each of my passages, expeditions or races, there's required to be a master and chief mate, which essentially a both qualified masters, really, a skipper and a backup skipper, really, in case one of us was incapacitated, on the basis we can safely get our crew, our expedition crew or racing crew, safely to the destination. So my ideal has been finding, you know, people at skipper level that are deeply experienced, they've done tens of thousands of sea miles, but equally that they fit our team culture, that they're not just autocratic, lone cowboy delivery captains that are used to throwing a couple of, you know, wannabe volunteers on board, but that I actually find good people. They share great stories. They're good teachers. They have good experience, and they have systems skills as well. So they bring something else to the table. You know, I've spoken to probably 30 or 40 people now. I now have a handful of qualified and approved people that you'll meet on upcoming passages or races if you join me, but also on the podcast as well. And good people, good backgrounds, good stories to share. And, you know, Matt, who recently did the Hamilton Island to Southport passage, the 500-mile passage, sorry, 630-mile passage, had previously crossed the Tasman Sea and it ended up on a para anchor for 3 days and 90-knot winds and 14-metre seas. And not an experience that he would have chosen to be in, but great lessons learned out of surviving that some years ago on a large vessel. And, you know, and it's, so these kind of people, they're great to have on board. I learn from them. I get to share some great adventures with them. And equally, they get to do some fun stuff, because some of those people as qualified sea captains have been on vessels where, as Matt shared with me, he's kind of got sick of, you know, delivering 150-foot yachts for wealthy owners, where you're also the glorified waiter, and you get complaints such as, there's not enough bubbles in my champagne, can you please replace my glass? And those kind of special kind of people, shall we call them, on board yachts that are rather pretentious, aren't the kind of people I'd love to go sailing with. My focus is on hands-on sailors who come for a sailing experience, but I can see why there's an attractive side to coming sailing on Silver Fern for qualified sea captains, because they get to have some hands-on fun. We go to some great places. So don't hesitate to drop me a line, email-wise, david@oceansailingexpeditions.com.au, if you're interested in joining our list of potential chief mates and co-skippers. So anyway, to recap, I guess the last time I shamefully I published a podcast episode was the preview of the America's Cup finals between Prada and Emirates Team New Zealand, and we all know how that went. And I'm glad that this episode replaces that one on the podcast website, because obviously that's been gone. The result was fantastic. It was amazing to be on the water to see those boats up close. It was a fantastic experience, and for me, after so many months of being parked up in a boatyard or on the hard sand or on a marina working on Silver Fern, it was just nice to get out on the water. We had 20 to 30 people out on Silver Fern each day. I'd never done any day trip type stuff before. It was a 5 a.m. start each day at the supermarket by 6 a.m. People arriving to go out for a sail by 9:30 a.m., departing at 10 after a safety briefing. Great day on the water, watching the racing, back in the viaduct in the Auckland Basin between 7:30 and 8 p.m. at night, in bed by 11 p.m. And ready to get up and do it all again the next day. So it was a hard slog, and I won't try and make it sound like it was hard work, because it was hard work, but man, I loved being out on the water. It was fantastic. And sharing that with like-minded people who just come out because they want to be on a sailing vessel and talk sailing, I love that. So I had a great time. It was, you know, hard by day, hard by night, but, you know, I wouldn't change it for anything. But I certainly couldn't be in that business where all you do each day is take out a new group of people, and it's a long day from sunup to sundown, and you get up again, do it all again the next day. It's so much easier going offshore on a 7 or 14 day passage than it is taking, I guess, day trips out, if you want to call it that, to watch the racing. But it was fantastic. And certainly doing it day after day after day was hard work. And by the end of the cup, I was pretty exhausted, and I just wanted it to actually end. I didn't want it to go 6-all and down to the best of 7. Partly because I thought bloody Jimmy Spittle will win if we do that. And partly I was just buggered, and so I was quite happy for it to end when it did, and even to the point where the last 2 days of racing, I'd stopped taking any bookings for that 2 weeks before. Obviously, those dates came about through the COVID delay, so those dates were never really part of the original schedule. On the last 2 days, I just went out with a smaller group of family and friends and just enjoyed it. And the last 2 days was a real privilege to have Martha and Bryce on board, the previous owners of Silver Fern. It was just an amazing experience to share the last 2 days of the Cup. To see New Zealand win on Auckland Harbour and being a Kiwi myself, you know, that's just, you know, something you dream of seeing up close that you think is probably unlikely to happen in your lifetime. You know, lining up the dots with, you know, actually defending the Cup on New Zealand waters and actually being able to be there, you know, which was pretty hard to achieve. And even with, particularly with the border issues as well. But I had a great time. It was a real privilege to have them on board. And I think it was they really appreciated being on board, seeing all of the investment in Silver Fern, knowing Silver Fern's in great hands, knowing that, you know, paying full respect to their legacy of 20 years of ownership from finding Silver Fern to stripping her back to bare hull, extending her 12 feet, rebuilding her from the ground up over 3.5 years, going sailing around the world for 12 years and creating the best memories of their life, and then seeing you know, a whole new lease of life at Silver Fern with me and under Ocean Sailing Expeditions. And I did record a 6-hour marathon session with Martha and Bryce of their travels around the world. I've got to invest probably 30 or 40 hours of editing that, and it probably ended up being 2 or 3 episodes. So be patient, that's coming. And that's part of my goal now. And I can edit while being offline, so that's part of my goal now, to get that edited and out and to dive into their treasure trove of photos. Martha's going to share some photos that I can share with all of you, and I've got some great photos of how Silver Fern used to look as a 60-foot vessel that I'll share with you as well in the coming weeks. So, as always, the future of the America's Cup is uncertain. The media love to love it and love to hate it. But I tell you what, I think it's exciting. It's in exciting hands. You know, being a catamaran or monohull diehard, you know, that's an exciting vessel to have as part of the design for the Cup. They're committed to that for the next two editions. It may well be held in Europe somewhere, and that's okay. That's good for the Cup if it keeps it alive. But it was fantastic to see these boats up close. So I had a blast. So basically, I wanted to just, I guess this, the latter half of this episode, I just want to share some of the challenges and lessons I've had in the past 5 or 6 months, some final thoughts, and then wrap it up. So I love to share good, the bad, and the ugly. I believe in doing that because that's how we all learn. I have lessons I learned sometimes through just bad luck, sometimes through bad management, sometimes through poor decision making, sometimes through just being out of my depth and happily, willingly taking on the unknown to learn from experiences and challenges. And I love to share those on the podcast, as you know. And I've had people come up to me lots of times over the years and say they appreciate, you know, both sides of life when it comes to sailing, not just publishing, you know, glamour shots and lovely locations and having you think that it's all just sun and roses and champagne, because as we all know, there's all sorts of challenges with sailing, and as my daughter says, there's no sweet without sour, and the highs are made high by but some of the lows you face along the way. So in terms of the challenges I've had recently, I had some real challenges in the early days with the hydraulic steering on Silver Fern. Just through sheer age, started to leak in some locations, and I'd never had hydraulic steering before. But of course, if you get air in your lines, then the steering doesn't respond as well. You get a little bit of play in the steering. Your autopilot starts to disengage if your rudder doesn't turn fast enough when it tells it to, as I had in my first Tasman crossing. And despite spending money on replacing rams, by the time I got to the America's Cup, I had steering that would alter course between 3 and 7 degrees, even though I was holding the wheel straight and trying to steer a straight line. And it got to the point where, on its worst day, randomly altering course, I mean, I could not steer the boat straight. And autopilot just kept disengaging. It was randomly altering course 3 to 7 degrees while I'm out on Auckland Harbour, surrounded by thousands of spectator boats, and it was just really stressful. So at that point, I decided that, you know, fix it once, fix it forever. Got advice that you really after 20 years of use and with four of those years sitting still not doing much, then really the way to bulletproof it was to replace all the hydraulic lines, replace the rams, replace the hydraulic pump, replace the autopilot pump, and just start from fresh. And I've bit the bullet and done that, and now steering's fantastic. And that's just, you know, sets me up for being able to confidently take Silver Fern offshore and across the Tasman. I could not imagine this size vessel being in, you know, 10 meter seas and not being confident in the steering and having hydraulic leaks that of course, as you increase the load, the leaks increase. So that became a real priority for me. And particularly after my experience, you know, 15 months ago now, losing my steering crossing the Tasman after a reasonably new steering cable broke. Knowing how a boat is disabled without steering, even with the ability to manually steer a boat, then steering's just critical on this size vessel, 72 feet, 30 tons. And then my next job is later this year is to install a completely separate standalone hydraulic ram off a completely separate backup autopilot pump and brain, so that in future if I was to lose my hydraulic steering system and or my autopilot, I've got a second system in place. And that's probably about a $10,000 to $12,000 investment to set that up. But again, after my experience of hand steering 500 miles with emergency steering last year on my Beneteau with a block and tackle, I would not want to do that again. And so having a whole separate redundancy system is part of the plan. One of my other frustrations was a rigger that in Auckland replaced all of my standing and running rigging, having a real poor attitude to after-sales service. You know, doing everything at the last minute, after the deadline, and not double-checking things are right. And without diving into major detail, I had really, really big issues with rig tension and lack of rig tension. I had a mast that would flex upwind to windward, going to windward. Often you'll have shrouds flexed on the leeward side. I had them flexing on the windward side because of my tension issues. I ended up with cracking as a result around my inner force stay plate that bolts the base of that stay through the cabin top. I ended up with cracking in the deck, surface cracking around the base of the mast. And then things really came to a head on a delivery trip from Whangarei to Auckland off New Zealand's east coast. I got back to the viaduct. I noticed a big black streak of grease down the side of the mast below my first spreaders. I got my binoculars out, and a nut that held both lower shrouds to the mast on the starboard side was basically one turn from completely coming off and falling off. And if that had happened, then nothing would have supported my mast from deck to second spreaders. And the night before, we'd been sailing downwind on a starboard jibe in 20 to 25 knots, and we were one turn away from both those shrouds coming off completely, the mast bending to leeward, probably breaking and probably going overboard. So at that point, I contacted this rigger who was now out to issue number seven after the $80,000 I spent on brand new running rigging, standing rigging, furler forestay, et cetera, and instead of being apologetic, instead of welcoming my call, he was just irritated once again that I had a problem and was busy focused on who he could blame. Somebody must have touched the rigging, somebody must have tuned it, somebody must have touched the mast. It wouldn't have been me, instead of accepting where things were. So at that point, realizing how close I'd come to losing the rig, I lost complete confidence at that point. And you know, right back to, you know, he set up a preventer system that failed the first time I used it crossing the Tasman, which then caused a crash jibe in 20 knots crossing the Tasman with just my wife on board, which then led to cracking around the gooseneck on the mast by the time I got back to New Zealand, and a complete refabrication and replacement of the gooseneck fitting being required. So, you know, you get to a point where if you do more of the same, you get more of the same. At that point, I decided enough was enough. Lives are at stake. I called Gulf Harbour Rigging in Whangaparoa in Auckland, who had previously I'd worked with on my Beneteau, had re-rigged my Beneteau, who had been my previous boat owner's also rigger of choice. And they came down to the Viaduct Marina. They uncovered multiple issues with rig tension, with the way it was set up, with S-bends in the mast, and then with inadequate locking systems on nuts that held critical components together, where the wire was just inadequate, had cut through with the movement of the mast instead of, you know, split pins drilled through the ends of bolts and et cetera, et cetera. So they spent 2 days sorting it all out, sorting all my tension out. And you know, it's just a lesson that a chain of events is a trend, and not to persist with bad advice. If you get to the point where something's big enough that there's been enough issues go wrong where you need to think about changing who you're working with and cutting your losses, because forcing somebody to fix something under warranty, if they're not capable of doing it properly the first time, means they're probably not going to fix it properly the second time. And if the downside is, you know, you're putting your vessel or your life at risk, you're better off just cutting and running and then paying somebody else to fix a problem and having peace of mind. And as hard as it seems at the time, because you want things to come right, that's what you have to do. And that's been my experience to date a number of times now over the years. So rig sorted, so that was good. Auckland to Southport, we then left Auckland. And so after the America's Cup, late April, we had real challenges, of course, because borders had been closed in bits and pieces. But anyway, crew of six, we're leaving the viaduct on the 20th of April. The goal was to get away by midday. There was some pretty heavy weather coming later that evening. Forecast of 35 to 40, gusting to 50 knots from the east. So we thought we'd get away at midday. If we clear Whangaparoa and Kauau Island, which are, you know, through the Turi Channel, get clear of the land, get 2 to 3 miles east of the coastline, then we'll be in deeper water, nicer sea state before the weather hits. At least we'll be able to, you know, reach up the coast. We'll have staysail, reef the main, and we'll seal things down. And it'll be a good test for Silver Fern. I was keen to test the staysail in conditions like that, and you know, best laid plans. And so we leave the viaduct. It's now about 1 o'clock because of a couple of last minute issues to sort out that morning. We'll leave the viaduct at 1 o'clock. We're about 20 minutes out of the viaduct, and I start to smell a burning smell, and quickly send somebody down below, and we've got smoke starting to come off the top of the engine block. The temperature's now started to crank up to sort of 80 degrees, heading up into the red. It's now at 90 degrees, and I realise the engine's overheating. No idea. We checked coolant, we checked oil, no idea what's going on, but I realised that we need to get engine turned off pretty quickly. And so we basically changed course. We crossed the harbour to the other side, to the naval base. We come in there, we chock the engine right back to lowest possible revs, you know, it's blowing 15 to 20 knots at this point, but we get the anchor out and down, go below and to have a look. And radiator's dry, we can't really figure out what's going on or why we've used all the coolant. And so make a couple of phone calls, get agreement that if we head back across to West Haven, which is about 2 miles away, there's an engineer that'll look at the engine. So we wait a good half an hour for the engine to cool down enough. We start it up again. We slowly start putting cold water and coolant back into the radiator, and we put 10 litres of coolant into this radiator. And the manual says it holds 14. So we'd use 10 of 14 litres of coolant in that small amount of time crossing the harbour, and no idea why, no idea what's going on, what's happening. Anyway, we motor sail back across the harbour. Engine doesn't really overheat, gets to normal temperature. We get in there, we get tied up in 20 knots. Engineer comes down, has a look at the engine, and notices that there's a drain tap at the base of the engine that, if you open that, drains all of the coolant out of the engine. That tap is half open, and it happens to be half open right beside where that morning a contractor has run my brand new fuel lines with my brand new fuel filters, where I changed from a single to a double fuel filter system, and clearly, unfortunately, knocked that tap half open, and hence the coolant's drained out into the bilge, and then been we've got some pink stuff sloshing around the bilge, and some of it's been pumped overboard. And so he closes it off, makes some changes, does some checks, finds a couple of other leaks that were slow leaks, changes some hoses, and we get it all filled back up. And then he tests it at 2,500 and then 3,000 and 3,500 revs to make sure everything's operating normally, and away we go. The trouble is now, you know, it's, you know, we've we planned to depart Auckland at midday. It's now 5 p.m. We're now probably 4 hours away from that weather hitting, as opposed to 10 hours away. And, you know, this is where, you know, schedule and deadlines versus judgment come into play. And so we figure, okay, well, we're pretty confident. You know, we'll get out of the harbour. We'll just take it easy. We'll head north. If the weather starts to come in from the east northeast, we can shelter about 4 or 5 hours away in the lee of Whangaparoa, anchor if we have to, wait for that weather to pass. Because it's supposed to pass in 4 or 5 hours and then head off. Anyway, we're now heading up Auckland Harbour. We've got two reefs in the main. We've got the staysail out. The wind's 15 to 20, then 20 to 25, and then the rain comes through and we can't see anything at all. It's an easterly, so we're tacking our way up the harbour. Got a brand new crew on board, and four of them haven't sailed in these conditions on Silver Fern before. We're now having to manage running backstays and tacking and in a harbour with commercial vessels. And it's a bit of a challenge to get out of there, and we've got to have our wits about us. But we get out of there okay, and we tack, and then we're then going up the channel from North Head to Whangaparoa, and the wind builds and builds to, you know, 20, 25, then 30 to 35. And it's okay. It's easterly. We're going upwind. We're not quite going to clear the headland. We're doing 8 to 9 knots. We're heeling 10 to 15 degrees. And with two reefs in the main and the staysail, we're going pretty well. And so what I probably should have done was tack out into deeper water at that point. But I figured, okay, if I go up to go up the channel, head north, end up in the lee of Whangaparoa, by the time we tack across under the headland to the channel that we have to then tack our way through, the winds will be tacking the lee of the land, and we'll have nice sail across, and then we'll tack out in the exposed breeze again and up through the channel. Trouble was, by the time we got to the Tiri Channel, which is a channel between the headland and an island, and it's, I think it's only 10 or 12 metres deep, now because of sea, the wind's now built to 35 gusting 40, and the 40 gusting 45, the seas are also built up, and we find ourselves with a nor'east breeze, trying to go upwind and not being able to lay the headland, and the sea stage starting to get quite steep. And so we were unable to maintain the headway at the angle required going upwind. We're probably another 10 degrees off now because of the sea picking us up and moving us sideways. And so we figure that clearing the going up through the channel is probably not going to be possible safely. And so why don't we just backtrack west? The headland's just there. Let's go along the headland to a bay called Shakespeare Bay. We can tuck in around there. We will have some protection from a sort of rock face at the end of the beach that's on the eastern end. And let's just wait 4 or 5 hours for the weather to pass. And then we'll, like, you know, either head off again at 2 a.m. or first light once we see what happens. The trouble was, as we tacked to go along the headland, all went well. You know, the wind's blowing, still blowing fairly strongly. And we get along there. And as part of heading into the bay, we've got to get a staysail down. We've got to get engine started, we've got to get mainsail down, then we've got to tuck ourselves into the bay and get from what I anticipate will be, you know, 30 to 35 knots at this point into sort of six to 10 knots once we get a bit of shelter. Trouble we have is as we go to drop the staysail, the halyard is controlled from the base of the mast. An experienced crew member has the halyard out around the winch ready to drop it. The tail of the halyard runs down the cabin top, spray coming overboard, wind blowing, runs down the cabin top, out through the scuppers, overboard, and around the prop. And I didn't realise this until the engine just suddenly stopped. The engine stopped, started again, stopped again, started again. It would work in reverse, but not going forward, and stopped again. So we're now in a lee shore situation with a sort of east-northeast breeze. We're trying to sail a sort of a nor'east course into the bay. We're not going to clear the headland. The bow's pointing into the bay, but the course over ground, which doesn't lie on the chart plotter, says we're going to cut the corner and hit the rocks. So we now have an engine that's not operable. We have no staysail up because the halyard is now stuffed, so we can't even get it back up. The mainsail in these conditions with a sea state doesn't allow us to go upwind, and we're now kind of pinching our way as high as we can upwind, but doing about 3 knots of boat speed. Because of that, and because of the approaching lee shore, I can't bear away to build boat speed because the land's right there. Equally, in 3 knots of boat speed, I wasn't confident we could tack away from the land through the 1 to 2 meter chop, steep chop at that point, and tack to build speed and have another go at it. So the challenge we've got is we're now sliding towards a lee shore. We're not going to make the corner into the bay, and there's a cliff face there, and there's rocks, and there's a whole lot of hard stuff, and it's not looking very good. So we make a decision that come hell or high water, even with the mainsail up, we're going to drop the anchor 120 meters from the shoreline, because that's a 3 meter contour at low tide, and basically that's the cutoff for, you know, go or no go. If we can't go into shallow water than that, because we're going to end up in trouble. So we get ready to drop the anchor. We realize we're not going to make the corner. We've got the mainsail up. It's still blowing 20 plus knots, and we've still got a very stay sail that's partway down, but not all the way down. And we just have to anchor and attach ourselves to the planet before we get ourselves up on the rocks. So we fire the anchor. We all wait with bated breath as it goes overboard as quickly as possible. And we drop about 30 meters of chain in what's supposedly a 3 meter contour, and we come to a standstill according to the chart plotter right on the 2 meter contour. Remember, we've got a 2.2 meter keel, and about 70 kilometers from the cliff face. 70 meters from the cliff face. So we're now held. The anchor's now holding, but the trouble we've got is the mainsail is still up. There's so much breeze, and no matter how far we use the boom out, it's still trying to sail us over the anchor. So the biggest challenge was then, and this is now after midnight, was to climb up and reel that mainsail down while it was under load. Luckily we had two reefs in it, to get it down to take the load off the sail and off the boat. So eventually we got the mainsail down, we got the jib down, and we got ourselves back down inside the pilot house, and it's now about 1 o'clock in the morning. And we hear a call from the Coast Guard calling our vessel, who says a member of the public's concerned. They saw our lights disappear from above under the base of the cliff, and what they wanted to check if we need any assistance. So I explained our predicament, explained that we figured we've got the halyard around the prop, that we're anchored securely, that we're going to wait till first light to inspect it, and we'll let them know if we need any help. By the time we sat there and had hot chocolates and a bit of a chat and a bit of a debrief, it was 2 a.m. We set up an anchor watch. We all took turns at just keeping an eye on depth and on the vessel's location on the chart plotter. And ironically, we never had less than 5 minutes under the keel, which was great. And we got up the next morning after having some reasonable sleep between us. I'm still reasonably shell-shocked and exhausted. And one of our crew, Mark, jumped in the water and took about 45 minutes to cut that halyard wrap away from the prop. So, you know, we could have ended up on the rocks. We could have said it wasn't our fault, that it was just bad luck that the halyard went around the prop and we ended up in that situation. But, you know, again, if you think about a chain of events, the lesson was, you know, if you go all the way back to where we started, once we had the engine set back and we didn't leave Auckland midday, it was 5 p.m., we should have just said, let's just go at first light. Let's just wait for this weather that we know is coming to pass through. Let's just go at midnight after it's gone through. Let's just get some sleep. Let's just take the risk out of the situation and wait. And so, you know, we could have waited and not set off that chain of events that almost led to, what could have ended up being the loss of the vessel. So, you know, you never underestimate how much the sea state stands up in a shallow channel or a shallow passage, or of course on a lee shore. As you get closer to the shore and into shallow water, that sea stands up. And you know, the trouble with an anchor, it's not usually the strength of the wind that tears it loose. It's the vessel rising up and falling, that bow riding up and crashing down, that tears that anchor out of the ground, out of the mud, or out of the sand. We were lucky that we had some protection. We were lucky that a 30-ton vessel does insulate you from that rocking to some degree. We were lucky we fired the anchor when we did. We were lucky that we made some decisions to salvage the situation. But I just want to share that with you because, you know, it gave me a fright. But it just shows you, you know, the old, you know, check there's no lines overboard before you start your engine. Briefing your crew to make sure that there's no risk of lines going overboard. Having your anchor ready to go. We departed the viaduct to head to Opua. Normally, I would have, strapped the anchor down, turned it off, and made sure it was isolated so that there was no risk of it going overboard or coming loose. Some instinct said, let's just wait till we're clear of the coast before we lock the anchor down, till we tie it down, turn it off, etc. And in that situation, seconds would have made a difference. We were down to seconds to get that thing down and anchored to the bottom and attached. And even when you're lowering as fast as you can, the chain only goes out so fast. So, just think about the plan B with these situations, because judgment usually comes from bad experiences and learning lessons that don't take your life. Judgment doesn't always come from good experience. Complacency can come from good experiences. So we headed out across the Tasman eventually. We got to Opua. We left Opua after clearing customs. Headed out across the Tasman, had a great sail, and couldn't stop at Lord Howe Island because of the COVID border issues, but we were determined to stop at Elizabeth Reef, go ashore. I've stopped there 3 times previously. It's a great experience off the Australian coast, about 300 miles. We anchored at Elizabeth Reef right on time, right on the tide, right where we wanted to be, right on daybreak, and we're all sort of, we've had breakfast, and we look out at the horizon, and we see dark cloud on the horizon, and judging by the direction of the weather, it's headed our way. We use a radar to verify there's some rain in that, and probably squalls in the front of that. The forecast was 10 to 15 knots, and we were anchored inside the sort of kidney of the reef, and so what that means is we had a slight lee shore situation, and although we had, although we're anchored in sort of 8 meters of water, we're 200 meters on each side from the reef, that if that anchor comes loose and we end up on the reef, we're now 300 miles off the coast of Australia. We have nobody coming to help us, and we're in a dangerous situation. So, on one hand, it's like, well, we all want to go ashore and explore the reef. On the other hand is, I had this bad feeling about what was coming weather-wise. I discussed the options with the crew and said, option A, option B, these are the options, these are the risks. What do you think? And universally, everybody agreed that let's pull the anchor up, let's head back out to sea, let's go a couple of miles off the reef, let's just sail backwards and forwards, we've got a bit of time, let's just see what happens with this weather. Sure enough, we get the anchor up, we're heading out of the reef, and within minutes, 25 to 30 knots comes through, the squall comes through, double what was forecast, and then even when it passes, it settles on a solid 20 past knots, and then the ripples that are now on top of the little lagoon, I mean, we couldn't go across the lagoon anyway. It's 6 miles long, and you need to be able to see the bottom, and it kind of destroys the experience if it's just a ripply, choppy lagoon, and it's going to be cold as well. 20 knots from the south, it's going to be cold. So, that's a good example of if you don't have a plan B, then get yourself out of the situation. And as much as we were disappointed, we got out of that situation, we waited for half an hour, the weather didn't look like it was going to ease, and we headed off to Middleton Reef and lived to fight another day. So, good outcome, good decision, and who knows, we might have got away with it, we might not have, but the lesson is don't take the chance. So a couple of other experiences. So, in June, we had a 630-mile south port to Hamilton Island passage inside Fraser Island, a pretty large sand island, that's about 70 miles from top to bottom, some shallow spots up there, and we ended up, as part of our trip, going into a place called Gary's Anchorage, and initially anchoring in a wider body of water, but travelling with another vessel that suggested that if we went further up, the anchorage was more protected. The channel was narrower, but more than enough water. So we did that. We anchored for the night. The channel was maybe 80 or 100 metres wide. So it doesn't sound like it sounds like a lot, but when you've got a 20 metre vessel and you put down 30 metres of chain, then you've got 50 metres in each direction from, swing extreme. So essentially 100 metres of clearance that you then need if you swing from extreme to extreme. So you've got to make sure you've got enough water to do that. So anyway, we could have headed back out the way we came the next morning, the southerly way. It would have made more sense. But we were convinced to go out the northerly way through a narrow northerly exit. That was as skinny as 20 metres wide. So in our case, can't turn around. But, as long as we went out on high tide, enough water, et cetera, et cetera. So for us to go out on high tide and have half a metre under the keel, that required us to do that at 5 a.m. And what it required was a bit of a dog leg turn as we exited the anchorage before we joined the main kind of body of channel again, where the main water flow was down inside Fraser Island. So a couple of things that happened that I didn't anticipate and didn't manage well. In the pitch black, of course, I'm relying on the chart plotter for navigation, because you can't just follow the channel markers. They're so spaced out that the shape of the channel, if you just follow the channel markers, you'll cut the corner and get yourself in trouble. So I'm following the chart plotter to navigate out of here, and as a result of that, as we get to this little dogleg and I start to make the turn, the lag in time with the GPS lodging the vessel's location on the chart plotter was enough to stray slowly to the port side of the channel and hit the mud. This channel is 20 meters wide, so of course if we're in the middle, you know, as we stray to that, on making that turn, the current, we get the full current hitting the vessel from the main channel, and the lag time with GPS in the dark, don't steer the boat accurately enough, stray to the side of the channel, touch the mud, come to a standstill. And the trouble is, we're at the top of the tide, and so unless you reverse off quickly, you know, the water level's falling. And this is in a location with a 2+ something meter tide. So we went straight into reverse, but even moving at 3 knots as we were, the length of Silver Fern's keel is about 10 meters. It's a long, flat keel. And it's about, it's the width of the keel is probably at least 20 centimeters or, you know, I don't know, 8 inches wide. So a lot of surface area touching mud, which of course is sticky, and we don't manage to reverse the vessel out. We call up another vessel, Bellamy, 45-foot Jono yacht, good friend Barry on board, and say, Barry, we've got a problem. Sorry to wake you at 5:30 in the morning, mate, but can you give us a tow? Barry comes over. He's there within 20 minutes. We get a head from the top of Silver Fern onto Bellamy. We get the mast over to at least 20 degrees, and it doesn't budge. And we realise that, you know, we're just going to do some damage here. And we realise we're now stuck hard. And the trouble is, we're stuck hard at high tide with a falling tide. And so we've got, you know, 10, 11 hours to wait before we've got enough water back over this area to float free. So the other challenge we had was, because we were right on the edge of the channel, the risk was if Silver Fern tipped towards the channel, then we'd be laying side on in deeper water, as Barry pointed out. And if we didn't get a line from the top of the mast across to the land to hold the mast to the land side of the vessel, if you like, so we could lay on the land, not keel on land, but body of body of hull in deeper water, we could end up with, you know, water coming into the yacht. So we've quickly got to strap together about 200 meters of lines. We have to take them from the top of the mast. We have to take them in a rib across the mud onto the shoreline and onto the land. We've had to find the nearest coconut palm. We tie those lines around the coconut palm. We start to tension them up as fast as we can. And Silver Fern goes from tilting slightly towards the water, towards the channel, to coming back towards the land. And now we're going to, you know, lay on the land as the tide goes out. And there's photos on the Facebook page from back in June of when this occurs. Now, I've never been on a vessel. I've run aground at least 30, if not 40 times in Ocean Gem, my Beneteau. I've never been able to, never been in a position of not getting the vessel off, and the most extreme time was waiting 20 minutes on an outgoing tide till we got halyard from the top of the mast and pulling the vessel off sideways. With a 30-ton vessel, crew weight doesn't really make a difference, even if you heel it over. Big long keel stays attached to the ground, doesn't work on the outgoing tide. So we now face a situation where we've got to wait for the water to go out. I don't know how far Silver Fern's going to heel over before she comes to a standstill. I don't know if that means water's going to start to come into the cockpit, into the boat, into the engine room vents. I don't know any of that. And it's a strange feeling as you sit there watching the vessel starting to heel. We also realise we've got to get the gear inside the boat stabilised, because, you know, if it heels to 30 or 40 degrees, well, all sorts of things are going to fall off beds and cabinet tops. And we also decide, well, we quickly need to get everybody ashore. We need to take the food that we need for the day. We need to take first aid kits. We need to turn refrigeration off. We need to turn everything off so that no matter what happens with the vessel, that there's no risk to the systems. So we do all that. We ferry everybody ashore. We make a call to the Coast Guard, of course, as part of that. They say that, you know, the only sensible solution is coming to see us 3 or 4 o'clock that afternoon when the tide comes back in. You know, it's now 6 o'clock in the morning, and helping us with a tow off on the high tide. We look at the high tide, and you know, again another big lesson. The high tide that night is going to be, I think, 2.6 metres, exactly the same as the high tide that morning when we ran aground. So what that means is we're only going to float as high as we did when we were hard on the mud, which means we're not going to be able to get off the mud. And so the only way to get off the mud then is to either heel the vessel over, well, we tried that to 20 degrees and that didn't work, or to make the vessel float higher in the water by removing weight. So we then spend the next 2 hours on a vessel that's now heeled to 25 degrees, removing about a ton of weight. We took as much as we could ashore as possible from, we dropped anchors off the bow into the mud on floats. We took the 250 kilogram storm drogue off. We took sails off. We took outboard motors off, and we took, of course, eight of our crew off, which again saves weight as well. So our theory was, if we can remove 1 to 1.3 tons of weight, then as a percentage of the 30 tons, that might give us the extra, you know, 10 centimeters or 4 inches of flotation that we probably need to get clearance. The other thing we then did was, when the tide went out completely, was to then look at the keel and how that sat in the mud, and even though it was still knee-deep in water, we were able to wade out there around the keel and spend about an hour and a half digging mud away from the keel on the channel side to, again, remove that friction, remove that stickiness, to hopefully make it easier to pull Silver Fern from the aft quarter back into the channel when it came to count. We'd only just finished, three of us, digging that mud out and then going back ashore to where the crew were relaxing, when a skipper of another vessel sent us a photo of a sign that was about half a mile away on the edge of the bank that said, crocodile sightings in this area, stay away from the water's edge. And here we'd been knee-deep in water, kicking up a hell of a mess with the mud. Crocodiles, of course, love the murky water. I'm digging away mud from the keel for an hour and a half, and facing the channel with our backs, and luckily no crocodiles were nearby that day. It gave us a bit of a fright. So anyway, did all that. Then spent the 3 hours remaining, relaxing ashore with the crew. Found a bit of wood, had a bit of a cook-up, ferried some meat ashore from the boat, had a bit of a barbecue, filled in time, went for a bit of a walk around the island. And then the next plan was then to get back on board by about 3:30 in the afternoon. Coast Guard was going to head down from Harvey Bay. It was going to take them about an hour to get to us. And anyway, they arrived. We got the vessel floating upright again, got lines attached, and about an hour before high tide, we managed to get Silver Fern floated back into deep water. And then basically on darkness, we got the crew back on board and loaded all the gear back on board and anchored back out in the middle of the channel. And we were all set, or so we thought. So a bit of a lesson there, but the lessons were to continue. So we're now anchored back in the channel, which I remember is about sort of 80, 90 metres wide. We'd anchored in the channel, but not dead centre, because what we'd done is one of the anchors we'd taken off Silver Fern, complete with 110 metres of chain on it, we'd taken in the rib, we'd taken down to from where we were aground to the middle of the channel, because we figure that once we get the vessel free, we've now got two anchors and chained links of chain sitting in the mud. Well, we're going to need one of those back on board to be able to anchor Silver Fern, and we're not going to be able to get it on board while it's sitting in shallow water. And just the background of that is the anchors and the chain, of which there's 200 metres of chain in total, weigh about 400 kilos, and that was a big part of the weight we took off. So one of the anchors with chain, we had to put in the rib, we had to take down to the where we wanted to end up anchoring, we had to put it on a float, we had to lower it over the edge of the rib and have it go overboard, and so that we could then bring Silver Fern up to it and bring the chain back on board so we could reattach an anchor chain to Silver Fern before putting the other chain and anchor back on the boat as well. So complicated story, but long story short, where we actually dropped the chain wasn't quite where we needed to. We decided to stay anchored for the night. Thought it was close enough to the centre of the channel, and it wasn't. So around 10 p.m., I hear this strange sound. I go to get into bed in my cabin, aft cabin. I hear this grating sound that I've never heard before, and it sounded very much like, when you think about what's touching the bottom, there's keel and there's rudder, and rudder shouldn't be touching the bottom. And it sounded like pressure on the rudder. So I went up to the cockpit, tried to turn the rudder, And sure enough, there's resistance on the rudder, and I figure that even though we're anchored in with 7 meters under the keel, the depth is measured from in front of the keel, the bow. Meanwhile, the stern swung as the tides turned, and we've now got the rudder touching the ground. So if you can imagine, you know, plenty of water under the keel, but just where the bank tapers up, we've now got a rudder touching the bank, which is terrible because you don't want, you know, it's one thing to run aground with your rudder, your keel, but you don't want to run aground with your rudder because who knows what structural damage you cause. So get up quickly, you realise we've got a problem, realise that as the tide's gone out and we've swung, that we're not as centre of channel as we need to be. And so in the process of pulling the keel, pulling the anchor up, because of where the anchor's located, we pull the rudder free but drive the keel up onto the bank, just enough to be aground. Fortunately, at this time, we're right on low tide, and so we figure it's just a matter of time before the tide comes back in. It's a 2.5 meter tide, and we swing free, and away we go. The issue we've got now is we're anchored on the edge of the channel, not enough water, and when the tide does come back in, of course, we're going to end up with a situation where any swinging we do is still going to be towards shallow water or the bank. So our only option now is to take the anchor off the bow, take 80 meters of chain at midnight, drop it into the rib, take the rib out another 30 meters to the center of the channel, and take that surplus chain across the channel, and then lower it into about 10 meters of water. So there's a couple of things here. When you're lowering an anchor with chain, the chain weighs a lot. And so the deeper that you lower that anchor, the more chain you have, which adds to the weight. So it gets heavier and harder as it gets closer to the bottom. And so we had realized from doing this earlier in the day that we needed at least three of us on board just to be able to hold the rib, hold the chain as it goes over the side of the rib to ease it down. The other thing you've got to do is you've got to put a protective layer, like a canvas or something, between the chain and the rib. Otherwise, the chain going over the side of the rib will just chafe through your rib and sink it. The other challenge we have is it's midnight, and we now know this is crocodile waters. And so we're now thinking, okay, we have to move this anchor so that as it floats free and swings, it just naturally finds itself back in the center of the channel. The trouble is going out to the center of the channel at midnight in the rib, in the dark, and lowering it over the side and making all the splashing noise in these murky waters means that, if you've seen Crocodile Dundee or any of the Steve Irwin stories, crocodiles love coming out at night and hunting, and we're in an inflatable rib, making a hell of a splash. And so it was actually quite scary lowering the anchor and the chain into the boat, leaving a crew member on board to manage easing the chain out, having us take that anchor and about 20 meters of chain out across the water, and then three of us lowering that over the side at midnight into the middle of the channel successfully, and then getting back to Silver Fern, getting back on board, etc. And clearly I'm here today to tell the story, so it all went well. Magically at 1 o'clock, as the tide started to come back in, we floated out, we floated free, and we floated back to the center of the channel, and happy days. The rest of the crew woke up in the morning, wondered what all the fuss was about. But, you know, again, 20-meter long vessel, big surface area on the bottom of the keel, 30 tons of weight, not easy if you run aground to get off the bottom. And so lessons learned in terms of not entering channels that are too narrow, not entering channels that you can't turn around in, not entering channels that you can't swing in, and just not entering areas where you have to wait for tide to give you enough water to get out of again. Because, again, if you have to get out in a hurry and you're reliant on getting out on the high tide, then, you really are restricted. And in our case, if you run aground on the high tide, you've got no wriggle room. And, I've always believed in, going anywhere, 1 to 2 hours prior to high tide when it's a bit skinny or a bit shallow. So you got the rising tide in your favour. We didn't that time, and again, that throwing caution to the wind, or that lack of judgment that caused us an extra delay of 24 hours. No harm to the vessel, but the story could have ended differently when you look at some of the contributing factors and how it all played out. And I mean, I now know that we can lay Silver Fern over on the hard, on the mud ideally, or on the sand. And it'll stop healing at 25 degrees. Well, that's good to know. If I ever have to beach Silver Fern to fix some fouling or a rudder issue or damage or or something fouled with the bow thruster went offshore, I know we can now do that on a mid-tide and float Silver Fern again and so on and so forth. I now know that the heel's to 25 degrees, no water comes into the boat, no water comes into the cockpit. It's designed for doing that. And, of course, the steel hull, then, you know, even with shells and bits and stones, you know, no harm occurs. So, anyway, good lessons, and I wanted to share that lesson because, you know, I learned a lot out of that, and I'll be wiser in future and more cautious. And you know, even recently I've still come down through, been up and down through the Broadwater three times now, between Gold Coast and Brisbane, in spots where there's less, well, between 0.1 and 0.6 of a metre under the keel, two hours prior to high tide, so a bit of upside there, knowing full well that you've got to concentrate when you're navigating, knowing that area, because I've navigated it 20 times in my previous vessel. It's a 40-mile stretch between Brisbane and the Gold Coast, but it does remind you, you've got to have a plan B, you've got to have wriggle room, you've got to have upside if you stray and touch the bottom, you've got to have a rising tide, otherwise, you know, things can end differently. Okay, so another lesson before I get to the final thoughts for this episode, well, another couple of lessons, I guess. On the trip to Hamilton Island, I think by day four of the eight-day trip, a crew member called me into the head at 9 p.m. It was full to the top of dark brown water, sewage in colour, and given it was brand-new toilet pumps, I was reasonably frustrated. We tried a number of methods to clear what we thought was a blockage. I removed the pump, the macerator wasn't jammed, and clearly the blockage was in the line. And we decided that maybe we could put something down the line and clear it. That didn't work. And it was in my wisdom, as part of the process when I disconnected the toilet line from the toilet, I didn't realize that as part of the freeing process, if I then applied the pump, the button for the pump, it would blow it out of the pipe at the base of the toilet, which was with such force that it rebounded up the walls in the head and hit me square in the face. And I didn't have any facial protection on, and this is basically shit, dark brown colored shit, and it was horrendous, and I wouldn't recommend it. I spent the next hour getting the head cleaned up, getting it isolated, you know, showering the whole thing out, getting cleaned up, disinfecting as much as I can, flushing my eyes out, which now sting. I'm pretty sure I'm going to get conjunctivitis by the morning, but I don't. Luckily, we've got two heads on board, and we get to Hamilton Island, and I go to organise a plumber, and there's none available. And then I kind of figure, you know, I just need to know the stuff, and there's not enough moving parts here not to be able to figure it out. And so, with the help of a couple of crew, I work out what we need. I go up to the Chandlery shop. They have just the right number of fittings, just the right number of pipe. I think I need 7.5 meters. They have 8. And I go through the process of replacing all of the blackwater pipe between the forward head and the blackwater tank. You know, takes a few hours, but job's done. And now I know intimately every single moving part between the head and the blackwater tank, and have now replaced all those parts. And you know, to be fair, after Silver Fern sat still for 4 years on the market, then that kind of stuff, you can tell with the weight of the new pipe versus the old pipe, that the calcification inside the pipe, it's a bit like cholesterol in your arteries, clogged up to the point where it got so narrow that the pipe just got jammed. I'm now the proud owner of the Boat Owner's Guide to Marine Sanitisation Systems by Peggy Hall. And then that's going to be some light bedtime reading for me. And I've now got some stuff on board that I'll use to help avoid the pipes blocking up as well. Another challenge overcome, and live to fight another day. But not very pleasant. But you have to be a plumber when you own a boat. On the return trip from Hamilton to Southport, all was going well. We were enjoying the new toilet lines, flushing with pride. And we get about a third of the way down the coast. Southerlies all the way to Southport, so headwinds. We decide to stop at Middle Percy Island, and after a bit of a rugged 24 hours, bit of seasickness, the crew are looking forward to a bit of a break. Anyway, we're coming into Middle Percy. The wind's blowing 20 to 25. It's an offshore breeze, and we go to start the motor as we approach Middle Percy, and the motor doesn't start, and we need to anchor in a bay. We need to get into the bay, which is upshore of where upwind of where we are. There's about 20 vessels in the bay. There's rocks at either end, and if you don't get into the bay far enough, you don't get out of the wind far enough, the water's not shallow enough, and you're going to roll around in the tide. But if we go in too far, the challenge is, you know, there's boats in there, and we can't afford to get too close. So the challenge is we have to kind of get the main away, reach up and reach down the coastline, zigzagging our way in with a furling jib, and then basically get into the bay enough so we can get out of the breeze enough and out into a shallow enough water that we can anchor. But equally, we need to manage, we need to use a radar now to measure where the other vessels are, so we have that 100 meter swing room, so we've got no risk on anchor of having any issues with swing. The other thing is there's a 1.5 knot tide running, and so we have to get Silver Fern to almost to a standstill, so that when the anchor hits the sand, that we don't overrun it. But equally, if we don't get the anchor down fast enough, then we start to swing in the tide. The wind hits the bow, shoves us off sideways, and as you know, when you drop your anchor, if your bow falls away, if you're not careful, it starts to drag your anchor sideways, and it doesn't grab the bottom. And our risk is if we're then moving at 2 knots with wind and tide, that again, with no steerage, we've got the risk of hitting other vessels or rocks. So so we have to kind of get ourselves to a point where we're sort of still doing about a knot and a half. We have to luff up the headsail as quickly as we can. And unfortunately, what we didn't anticipate is in the flapping headsail as we're furling it in, that clue flailing around in the 20 knots of breeze is then hitting the crew who are trying to lower the anchor, which they've got to lower from that spot. And it wasn't pretty, but they did pretty well to sort of get control of the sail, get the anchor going down, so that by the time we sort of came to a standstill, we had anchor hitting sand and it's starting to dig in. And then sure enough, you know, we got 20 meters of chain out and it dug in, and we were happily separated from the other vessels and pretty happy with ourselves. And again, you know, lessons learned, that if you don't practice that stuff, when you need to do it, and you've got to do it, you may not get it right. And fortunately, I have had to sail onto berths, onto fuel docks previously, or into places because of wrapped lines around props. And it's good to practice that stuff and be confident, because we either had to go in or leave and stay at sea, and that was an option as well, of course. But we wanted to really get the motor sorted. So the issue with that, which we fault-finded, was corroded wires in the starter motor. Even though Silver Fern had been rewired, any engine related wiring was excluded from the survey requirement. And so on close inspection, there was some corroded joins, some corroded wires, there was some wires that had been damaged by heat where the casing had gone, and basically it was a you know, when you unwrap the tape from around it, it was a little bit of a mess. And so luckily a crew member, Matt, on board, chief mate, had a lot of electrical experience. It was a good lesson for me in learning to use a multimeter to identify problems and understand how to locate them, and then carrying, you know, a far more full electrical repair kit on board to be able to fix things, to make temporary repairs. And while I had some gear on board, not as much as I could have. And so we managed to get the wires repaired, the starter motor working, and resolve the issue temporarily. And then I committed to, when I got back to Southport, replacing all the wiring on the engine completely, and that's now been done completely on all the starter motor related stuff. And then I'm waiting for Yanmar on some engine loom stuff in terms of getting an entire loom replaced. And again, you know, it could run happily for years, or you get those niggly little corrosion issues where you just have bad connections, and then when you least expect it, you have issues. So that's now been resolved. But you know, good lessons in having tools on board, having a repair kit, and again, on Matt's advice, I'm now the proud owner of a manual that is 890 pages. It's called The Boat Owner's Mechanical and Electrical Manual by Nigel Calder. It's supposed to be an amazing book. I've now got that on board, and again, that's good bedtime reading for starting to understand systems and how they work, and understanding how to problem solve and find solutions. And the thing is with this stuff, you don't have to know all the answers. You just have to have the tools and the information on board to know how to find the answers. And most of the time, you do have the ability to anchor and take your time and fix the stuff, or you're in a marina berth. It's not like you've got to do it, you know, on the fly in an emergency situation. So you know, again, that's part of the journey for me. And again, I'm sharing the advice I've been given, and just sharing an example of how, you know, if your engine fails in the wrong circumstances, particularly when you're more remote, you can get yourself into trouble sometimes if the wind's not favourable. Either lack of wind or wind from the wrong direction when you've got a lee shore. So, you know, just to top it all off, we got back to Hope Harbour on the Gold Coast safely at the end of the trip. And so the irony of it all, it was we had no more engine issues on the way down the coast, and I went to shut the engine off, and we got back to Hope Harbour, and it wouldn't shut off. Matt showed me where the fuel cutoff valve was on the engine for starving the engine of fuel and cutting it off, which we did to shut the engine down. And faulty wiring, and it was part of what was being fixed when all that wiring's been replaced on the start and stop system. So amazing how these niggly little things occur. Okay, so that's kind of the bulk of the episode. And I just really wanted to finish off with a couple of things, really. Just a couple of final thoughts. And they've just been reinforced for me over the last 12 months, really, the last 12 to 15 months. This is just a bit of just general philosophical thinking, not really me standing on a lectern or giving you advice or having a rant or a rave. But, you know, final thoughts about, you know, the world's got a bit of turmoil right now, and there's a lot of unknowns. And in life, that's often the case. And I guess, you know, the biggest thing I've learned in the last 12 months, and that's really no matter what goes your way or what doesn't, you just have to accept where you are. And I think that if you struggle to accept where you are because you're too focused on why you shouldn't be where you are, or why it's not fair, or you know, why it should be different, or why it's someone else's fault, or why it could have been avoided, I mean, woulda, shoulda, coulda, it doesn't matter, because at that point you are where you are. And whether that's in life, sport or business or whatever, you know, people say, well, the reason is this and the reason is that. Well, reasons are excuses, and whether it's your reason or someone else's reason, you are where you are. And in the last 12 months, especially for me with this project, I've had so many opportunities to blame contractors, to blame COVID, to blame the weather, to blame Maritime New Zealand, and so on, for all the things that haven't gone to plan, haven't been on time, haven't gone to budget, haven't been delivered as promised, haven't been delivered as per the contract, careless mistakes or unfortunate errors that have led to other mechanical problems. You know, just stuff happens, and the trouble you've got is if you're too focused on being right and saying, well, I was right and you're wrong, it's your fault, it generally doesn't solve the problem once it's happened. And also, the other thing is, you know, blame just alienates people. And even if they've caused a problem, if they're part of the solution, you just get them offside if you focus on blaming them or giving them a lecture. Most people realise when they've made mistakes and don't need someone to tell them over and over that they've made them. And all of us have got our shortfalls, and I've got plenty. And so accepting where you are, regardless of how you got there, and focusing instead on what do we have to do to fix this or finish this, it's just way more empowering, it's way more productive, and it moves you towards the solution. And with people especially, if you want them to help you get to the finish line, you got to keep them on side. And so I just think, you know, and I've had lots of setbacks, I've had lots of disappointments. I mean, I just found out a couple of weeks ago that my brand new spread lights have stopped working, followed by my brand new anchor light, followed by my brand new masthead tricolor light. And coincidentally, I had somebody working on the mast that drills holes in the mast. And so I put two and two together and figured they drilled holes in the wrong place, and they've drilled through my brand new wiring from my $180,000 rewire of this vessel. And now I have not only no masthead lights, but equally now I have a problem, because now, based on my knowledge of this vessel, the only way to fix it properly is the whole mast has to come out of the boat, and it's got to be disconnected inside the cabin. The entire cabin setting has got to come out, and to really get to the source of the problem and make sure it's not just a band-aid, i.e. there's not other damaged wires we don't know about, we've got no choice now but to pull it out of the vessel. And that was just absolutely heartbreaking, but it's just life. And, you know, full credit to the company that has probably caused the problem, yet to be verified. They've said, okay, well, this is what we're going to do to fix it, and you're going to have to pull the mast out, and this is what needs to happen, and this is the time we need, and it's all about let's just get on and get it sorted. And it's frustrating for all of us. Creates headaches that I don't need, but you know, again, you know, threats, abuse, bad behaviour, blame achieves nothing. And so the better you get in life of accepting where you are, learning lessons so you don't keep repeating the same mistakes, or letting others repeat the same mistakes for you, I think the thing, the easier life is. And I've had to take things in my stride so many times in the last 12 months, and I just had to. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here today, mentally, financially, or physically. And the other thing is, you know, COVID-19 is a good example of that as well, I think. And I just, it's just part of the background right now for me, and it's bloody inconvenient. But this is by no means, this is just my opinion, right? I'm not telling you not to believe or to believe or whatever. It's just my opinion. But I am amazed at the people that have invested hours, tons of hours, hundreds of hours into researching all sorts of online content and blaming world governments, China, Bill Gates, Joe Biden, national country governments for wanting to somehow harm us or mislead us or, you know, scam us or microchip us. And, you know, I have no time to spend on that stuff, because here's the thing, right? I don't like what's happening in the world. I don't like that it continues to make my life difficult. I don't claim to know the real story, nor do I feel the need to, because guess what? I can't control it. I mean, I do believe in science. I'm a bit of a data guy. I know people that have been sick and recovered. I have friends who have had family members who are healthy who have died. And, you know, so it is what it is. That's just my experience. And everyone's had their own experience with this. But that's all that is enough for me to accept that I don't want to catch it. And each to their own, right? Again, some of you think it's common cold. I had pneumonia as a 17-year-old. I would never wish that on anybody. It was so painful. It was incredible. I wouldn't want to have that again. And I was told if I had it again within 5 years, I'd probably have lifelong damage to my lungs and probably shortened my life expectancy. And from my understanding, COVID's a bit like that. But all of that aside, like, here's the thing, right? I just have to accept that until things change with border closures that are unexpected, often announced at short notice, that I just have to have a plan B and plan C, and I have to be prepared to change my schedule, my life. I have to replace people who can't sail anymore from different states or different countries. I have to provide 100% refund guarantees, which is bloody difficult at times and financially stressful. I just have to hope eventually it'll get easier, because one of the things I've always done in my life, as much as possible, is work on a need-to-know, have-to-do basis. And what that means is, if I don't need to know it because someone else does, I just let them know it, and I just trust them to give me the knowledge when I need it, like a specialist, right? A doctor, a surgeon, a mechanic, whatever. If I don't have to do it, then I don't want to do it, because I'd rather spend the time doing the things I have to do. If I can pay others, delegate others, teach others, or whatever, then I have more time for what I want to focus on if I don't need to know everything and don't have to do everything. And this includes conversations with people who want to agonize over why it's not fair or why it shouldn't have happened or why the government should be doing this or should be doing that instead. Like, it's just, you know, it is what it is. And I'm not trying to be disrespectful of other people's opinions. I just don't want to focus on what I can't change. And I have limited time. I have limited mental and physical energy. And you do too. Like, and we all have the same amount of time each week, 168 hours. And so focusing on what you can't change achieves nothing. It actually just makes you feel more powerless, more, it gives you more reason to procrastinate. Whereas if you just accept where you are, that's what I found. If I accept where I am and I focus on what I need to do next to move forwards, even on the hardest days, if it's just one step a day, no matter how small that is, that's 365 steps a year. And you know, as Winston Churchill said, you know, if you find yourself in hell, keep going. Just keep moving forward, because eventually you'll get out of it. And like, whether that's the COVID limitations on your sailing, on your business, on your life, on your family, whatever, it just is what it is. And you know, I am so excited about what lies ahead for us as sailors. I can't wait for borders to open up again, for us to go cruising, sailing, racing again. It is all ahead of us. And in the meantime, I'm just going to do what I can do to keep moving forward. And I've overcome some big challenges in the last 12 months to get to where I am today. And I guess I just wanted to share those thoughts with you. Please don't take it as a political statement or a lecture or anything else like that. I just wanted to share those thoughts with you, because it's worked for me. And it means I can keep going forward. So anyway, enough of that. I'm going to wrap up this episode of the Ocean Sailing Podcast. It's good to be back, and look out for the next episode that's coming up shortly with Marianne and Kyle Webb, who I bumped into on the hard stand at the Bow Works in the Gold Coast a few weeks ago and pinned down for an interview. I'll get cracking on some new content and also on editing that amazing story that Martha and Bryce, previous owners of Silver Fern, are going to share as well. So thanks, folks. I hope you enjoyed this episode, and look forward to bringing you another one real soon.
Thanks for listening to another episode of the Ocean Sailing Podcast. Email your comments and suggestions to David at oceansailingpodcast.com.au.
If you'd like to find out more about how you can join me on board my yacht for an upcoming expedition, regatta, ocean race, or ocean passage, go to oceansailingpodcast.com and look for the Ocean Sailing Expeditions calendar with a complete list of events right up until the end of 2023 and some really exciting places, destinations, races, and regattas up and down the east coast of Australia, around Tasmania, across the Pacific to Fiji, and also circumnavigations of the North and South Island of New Zealand, along with a New Zealand Southern Islands expedition.
To a different place where love is not illusion based and fear is just a word they can't define, where I've heard hope and happiness are found in every beating chest, cause all those hearts are more or less inclined to give it all away without fear of what's to break. The answer that we never seem to find, the hand we always take disintegrates without a trace, and we're the ones they've always left behind. Help me understand, the best is yet to come. Take me by the hand before I moments pass me by, but I refuse to leave my life to fall between the cracks of my control. I was outspoken till I broke open all the chains that were imprisoning my soul. Help me understand, the best is yet to come. Try to swim the other way, then they'll never let you see another day.
But I've been there before, I've been a soldier in this war. If you take it in your stride, you might just see the other side. Just breathe, breathe, cause everything you see is just a stone.
Understand, the best is yet to come. Take me by the hand before I come undone. Cause all